All right. Hello, and thank you for joining us today for our webinar, What's New in DSE 6.8, The Making of a Cloud-Native Database. Before we get into our topic, I wanted to go through a few housekeeping items. Everyone on the webinar is muted and will remain so for the duration of this presentation, and that's to avoid any kind of background noise or distractions. Not that we have any of those right now. If you have any technical difficulties, typically refreshing your browser resolves that, so please try refreshing your browser. In addition, if you have any questions throughout our presentation, please submit them via the QA widget, and we will do our best to get to them during the later portion of this presentation. You can also find resources related to today's topic on the left side of your screen, which we invite you to explore throughout the presentation. All right, and with that, let's get going. So with me today is Ed. Hi, Ed. So Ed, you're a serious person, right? You describe yourself as a serial entrepreneur on LinkedIn. You read probably more than anybody I know. And I mean, you have a cat for Pete's sake. And because you're so serious, I thought we could like start off this presentation in a completely unserious way, mainly for my personal and the audience's benefit. What do you say?
Sure. Let's give it a shot.
Awesome. Okay, so I'm very excited. So Ed, what does C7A plus K8 equal?
Oh, I didn't realize we were gonna start with a math test. I really have no idea.
Okay, all right, let's have some fun. We're all stuck inside with nothing better to do. So instead of the standard, here's our new product thing, let's give this a shot. I'm gonna give you a hint. All right, here we go. Here's your hint, Ed.
Okay. Well, let's see. I think I recognize the K8S, so that's Kubernetes. Not sure where you're going with this.
Awesome. Yeah. So you certainly got Kubernetes. Let's focus in on the C7A, right? We know this piece of software really, really, really well. I would go so far as to say DataStax knows this better than anyone else. So if K8 stands for Kubernetes, because there are eight letters between the K and the S, what do you think C7A is?
Okay, I'll bite. That stands for Cassandra.
Awesome, that's right. Cassandra, the zero downtime, zero lock-in global scale database. Okay, so now we've got Cassandra and Kubernetes, were just missing the last piece. What do you think that could be?
Oh, you know, my guess would be, you know, something that had 15 letters between those two. So could it be cloud native data?
Ah, wonderful. That's amazing. All right, that was fun.
Awesome.
All right, so why don't you take us through the real presentation now, Ed?
Cool. So thanks everyone for joining today. My name is Ed Anuff. I'm the head of product for DataStax. Have been working in tech for a long time. Have been using Cassandra for a long time. Previously at Google, Apogee, and a host of other companies, doing stuff for the enterprise and so forth. Today I've got Jonathan Lacefield, or as we affectionately call him Lacey, who's our senior director of products for DataStax and handles all things DSE. And you know what we're going to talk to you about today is DSE 6.8, which is our latest and greatest release. As we with that whole setup talked about, this is all about being a cloud-native database, being the platform for cloud-native data, and yes, bringing it together with Kubernetes is a big piece of that, but there's a lot of other cool stuff in there, things like what we're doing with Guardrails, our latest implementation of Graph, and a bunch of other cool stuff that we're going to get into this webinar. So let's get started. So When we look at our topic for today, this is let's restate our mission, so, which is a DataStax. We're trying to connect every developer in the world with the power of Apache Cassandra, with the freedom to run their data on any device and in any cloud. At the heart of what we're doing is Apache Cassandra. That's what this company was founded on, in taking this amazing technology that's the product of great work from a base of fantastic developers around the world, and really trying to put that in the hands of every enterprise. And so we do that in three ways. And so first way is through our new pure open source Apache Cassandra support offering Luna, which makes it possible for any company to succeed with Apache Cassandra. The second way is through Astra, which makes Cassandra a turnkey experience. And then for the majority of our customers thus far, and will continue to be so for some time to come, is DSE, DataStax Enterprise, which is our flagship enterprise data platform. And that is the way that many companies around the world succeed with Cassandra and get transformational results. So one thing I do want to point out is that regardless of the way you want to work with NoSQL, the way you want to work with Cassandra, you always have a partner with DataStax. And this slide talks a little bit about that. And so I won't spend too much more time on that, but as you're thinking about Cassandra, definitely visit our website, take a look at the different mechanisms that we have, all the way from succeeding with open source, with the latest builds of Cassandra from the Apache community, all the way to having a turnkey experience in the cloud. So one of the things you've heard us say, and hopefully we continue to drive through in this presentation, is that Cassandra is at the heart of everything we do. And Cassandra was created I'm just scratching my head here. I believe around 2008 or so, developed by based on ideas from Amazon, based on ideas from Google, based on work done by Facebook. Since that time, many of the largest companies that have succeeded in delivering services on the internet, everybody from Apple to Uber to Netflix, a host of other companies, have turned to Cassandra when they need to be able to easily scale predictably, servicing users around the world. And it still is the best choice, and it's only just become more proven, more tested over time, continues to be when companies need to face the challenges of scale, when they want to go and have zero downtime, zero lock-in, being able to run on any cloud, being able to go and address the needs for global scale. So that's what we're trying to deliver with Cassandra. Today, that means not just delivering those capabilities, but doing it in conjunction with Kubernetes. And that's where we're gonna start off our conversation today with you about. Kubernetes has really taken off over the past couple of years, originating with some of the techniques used by Google for orchestrating containers. But it's really crossed the threshold to becoming a standard. You look at what's happening in terms of the ecosystem of people that are building around Kubernetes. You take a look at the KubeCon conferences around the world that have just scaled to tremendous size. Unfortunately, we're at a point where we won't be having in-person conferences, I think for a little while now. Hopefully those will start to happen again. But just the upswell in interest and activity, as a long-time technologist, the last time I saw things like this was when Java was first sort of sweeping the world, and you saw massive alignment around the ecosystem, around open source, around vendors all going and supporting a standard. We really have that today with Kubernetes, zero lock-in, global scale for your containerized applications. And that's very well aligned with the way we view Cassandra, zero lock-in and global scale. And basically, you know, our goal is to have all of these forces around data aligned with everything that's emerging and driving the future of compute. So that brings us to DataStax Enterprise 6.8 and some of our choices around that. So with 6.8, we're giving users the best way to operate Cassandra in a cloud native environment. And we do that with our cloud backplane, our management API, and we do that with the Kubernetes operator. With DSE 6.8, Kubernetes is now supported for production use. We've certified support for several of the popular Kubernetes platforms at launch, as well as certifying against the latest CNCF certified Kubernetes distros. And eventually you will just be able to go and go to the CNCF website. And if your distro of choice, and we've spoken and worked with a lot of you, we think that all of the major distros that are in widespread use in enterprises are supported right out of the gate. But this lets us get very well aligned with the CNCF certification processes. We also announced that one of the questions that people have had for us is this just around DSE? We've also announced that we're supporting open source Cassandra for experimental use, and a lot of what we're doing, we're contributing to the various efforts underway within Apache Cassandra and elsewhere for standardizing Kubernetes use. So our goal is really to get all forms of Cassandra to be very well aligned with this. But there's a lot more to 6.8 than just this. Adding the Kubernetes operator for DSC was super important, but we also need to deliver a bunch of additional functionality, things like zero-copy streaming to let users scale and recover from disasters much faster than they previously could have, letting them painless, avoiding the pain of migrations, being able to go and implement guardrails. So part of all of this is to be able to go and really make Cassandra a platform within your organization that you can use to onboard multiple projects. We've seen in the past that a lot of folks go and deploy Cassandra for their specific mission critical flagship application. What they've said to us is, we really want to sort of make this a platform for any of our projects that we can anticipate are going to need global scale, but we need to let people on ramp. We need to be able to enforce successful, safe, usage patterns. And so things like guardrails make this possible. At the same time, we've also had people go and say, look, you know, NoSQL really calls for new application patterns. And a lot of the things that we're trying to do, we want to support a much more dynamic relational model. We want to be able to let our applications go and leverage the power we see NoSQL affords us, but be able to go and have this more agile way of thinking about our relationships of our data and our graph engine within 6.8 lets us do that. Lets us go and start to as our application evolves, as we want to be able to connect data together in new ways in our applications, DSE graph lets us do that. And so the idea of this is to, overall with 6.8 is to give you new capabilities for going and deploying DSE and Cassandra against any infrastructure, both the existing bare metal ways that you as Cassandra users have expressed to us that you want to continue to be able to leverage and succeed with Cassandra within, but also let you get the best of cloud native, leverage containerized deployments, make it easier to do that, give you graph traversal techniques so that you have new options as developers to build exciting new applications, and give you a lot of new mechanisms for going and building better apps faster. So, a whole lot of things within 6.8 that are reasons to be excited. So, with that in mind, what I'm going to now do is hand things over to Jonathan, who's going to get into detail on what some of these features are and what they mean to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Ed. All right. So let's start with the Cassandra operator 4.6.8. And so the operator uses a Kubernetes custom resource, and we call this the Cassandra data center. And this is the resource that is used by Kubernetes to deploy clusters. So we're going to walk through some examples here in just a second to show you how this works, how Cassandra and Kubernetes kind of work together through this operator and through the Cassandra data center itself. With DSE 6.8, we are supporting, as Ed mentioned, CNCF kind of certified platforms. Right out of the gate, it's GKS and the open source Kubernetes platforms, and you'll see us just rolling out certification for additional platforms as we move along here. And you can see, you know, on this slide, a few of the items that are in scope right out of the box with 6.8 that are ready for GA. So provisioning nodes, replacing nodes, scaling up, configuring deployments, and you get some rolling restart capabilities there, as well as version upgrades. So let's walk through a couple of examples to show you how Kubernetes and Cassandra work together. All right, so what we're doing in this first step here is to ensure that the infrastructure is ready for Kubernetes. Here you'll see how we are validating the version of Kubernetes running, the availability of the nodes, pods, for use in our cluster, and ensuring storage is available. All right, the storage YAML, by the way, and you'll get a lot more details on how to do this through our documentation, which you should see in your resources. But the storage YAML defines a type of storage for use for the Cassandra nodes in a cluster. And there's a ton of options, and you know, it's really malleable what you can do there. Okay, so once we kind of have the basics, next we install and start the operator. It's pretty straightforward. The command here deploys the operator along with any requisite resources, such as role or role binding, to the CAS operator namespace. Nothing fancy or magical yet. Okay, so here's where everything really happens. This is where Kubernetes and Cassandra come together. And this is the custom resource that we are providing as part of our operator. And we call this the Cassandra data center. So this is the YAML file where you will configure your Cassandra nodes themselves. There's an example file to use, again, on our DataStax documentation page, and there's a link to a GitHub few different samples, one with like every possible configuration that you would want that you can just use. Okay, so just a couple of callouts here. So here you can see the data center name that we've created. Dude, it's a little hard for me to read. I'm going to use my other backup copy. It's a little bigger. One second. Or not. Ah, there we go. Okay, so here we have a data center. We have the name of our cluster, Demo DC. You can see that we have one node configured under the size. So here, as you'll see later when we scale up, the size is what determines how many nodes you use. We have the 6.8.0 version that will be deployed. A couple of other items in here as well that can be configured for JVM override settings. You can pass, it's awesome. You can pass Cassandra YAML settings, DSE YAML settings. Everything happens from here, and then Kubernetes handles all the push and deployment. So let's take a look at what happens from that. We're ready to deploy and push this out. It's pretty simple. So basically, we use kubectl or kubectl, I've heard it called several different things, to deploy our Cassandra YAML that we created, the Cassandra data center. And Kubernetes will just sit there and start deploying, and you can watch progress start. So in this example, in the lower half, the top half of the screen, we are showing how the command to create our cluster, right? And you can see the single node cluster.yaml. That's our custom resource definition. You know, that is the Cassandra data center that we've defined. And as soon as we hit enter, you can see you can get progress using the git pods command option from kubectl. And what you're seeing here is just a screenshot of me running this over the past couple days kind of prep for our presentation. But you can see the very last line where it says node state started, ready 2 of 2. That indicates that our cluster is up and running and ready for use. That's how we know things are ready. Awesome. So now let's take a look at how easy it is to scale a cluster that's running. So at this point, we have a single cluster, a single node cluster running using Cassandra that we started with Kubernetes. So what I've done, I've copied that single node cluster.yaml to a new file, and I simply changed the size from 1 to 3. And this diff command is just showing the difference between the two YAMLs that I used to create this demo. And the only thing that's different is that size, right, parameter. And what this tells Kubernetes when we apply this using kubectl is that Kubernetes will see that, okay, I've got a one node Cassandra cluster. I'm now going to expand it to 3 nodes. So that's what we're doing here. And I'll show you what that looks like from a Gitpods perspective, and you can see the status. It's kind of cool. On the right-hand side, you'll see when we get pods, you'll see we still have that one node cluster. Everything's great, it's started. And then you'll see how Kubernetes is starting the additional pods using the new Cassandra data center custom resource for Kubernetes. Until finally, after a few minutes, everything's up and running, and now we have a 3-node cluster.
Okay, so we can do some other cool things with the Cassandra operator as well. So here we are changing a commit log sync, and just basically changing the duration, reducing it for the amount of time commit logs are synced to disk, so we know data is safe. And just like previously, all I have to do is update, I happen to create new Cassandra data center YAML files. You could update the previous one and just pass it in, have kubectl apply it, and then watch for changes as they take place. And after a couple minutes, the configuration has changed. What's really cool here is how the configuration is changed, with a rolling restart. Cassandra being always available, having zero downtime, it works really well in environments that, you can push things out node by node and your application remains online and stays available. And with Kubernetes and the Cassandra operator, that approach is baked right in. You don't have to tell the operator to go out and try to restart nodes one at a time to take advantage of best practices for configuration changes with Cassandra. Awesome. Okay, yep, and here is the status I was just talking about. All right, so this is just a quick glimpse of the Cassandra operator, how things work. Like I said, it's actually pretty simple to use, particularly for folks that are used to Kubernetes. This should be pretty intuitive. But check out our documentation page. If there's getting started portion for the Kubernetes operator, and a lot of great resources to help you be successful here. Now we're going to turn our focus to a few of the other items that Ed mentioned earlier. The first being how we've helped Cassandra scale faster and recover from disaster more quickly. So at DataStax, we believe that a cloud-native database should scale and recover linearly, quickly, and easily. This is true for a database as a service like Astra, and this should also be true if you have a need to run a database yourself, like with DSE 6.8. This is why in DSE 6.8, we've added optimizations that help nodes in your Cassandra cluster scale or recover more quickly. And this is a screenshot of our internal testing, which shows how we are receiving 4 times faster and better performance when adding or decommissioning nodes simply by optimizing the Cassandra component that shares the data between nodes during scale operations. So when I add a node or replace a node, that data's got to all be synced. And we focus there and remove some bottlenecks there. So cloud-native databases, regardless if you're interacting with them as a service or you choose to run them yourselves, should be elastic and scaling. And you can see this as us taking the next step to really achieving that with Cassandra, right? And what we're really going after and what you'll see is how we are truly making things elastic and self-healing. Okay, so now let's talk about how data can be elastic as well as kept consistent in a zero time database like Cassandra. So with 6.8, we've created another optimization on top of something called NodeSync. And NodeSync is the process that we use to keep data consistent across your cluster to make sure your replicas match. With incremental NodeSync, we basically took our first iteration of NodeSync, which was introduced in DSE 6.0, and we've optimized it so that we can be smart about the data we sync across your cluster. And what I mean by this, very hand-wavy implementation description would be we kind of keep a register of data that's been synchronized or not. And if new data comes in that changes the state of an already synced record, we will sync that data. But we won't go back and retouch any of the data that's already kept in sync. So what this means to you is that as you scale your cluster sizes, your data is kept in sync. The process is a lot less resource intensive, a lot more lightweight. And for your applications, you're getting more consistent data from an always available zero downtime database. Okay, so now let's kind of shift gears a little bit and talk through let me show you a little bit more about incremental NodeSync. Sorry, I forgot I added this slide. So by default in DSE 6.8, incremental NodeSync is enabled. And if you have an existing cluster and you upgrade to 6.8, you can change, you can add NodeSync and add the incremental NodeSync function simply by using some of the DDL code here, using an alter table statement. The width here is the line that you use to configure NodeSync. So this is something that's configured through CQL and not at the full cluster level itself. Okay, so now let's take a look at guardrails. Awesome. So in 6.8, we've introduced a configuration that's global to a cluster to help you mitigate the chance that an inadvertent issue introduced by an application could cause stability issues with your cluster. Apache Cassandra is a powerful database. We all know that. And as Uncle Ben said in Spider-Man, I really hope I got that name right, by the way. With great power comes great responsibility. I'm sure I will find out if it wasn't Uncle Ben. Anyways, historically, Cassandra users... Sweet. I asked my kids last night, and they kind of ghosted me on that. So. Historically, Cassandra users have tried to mitigate potential cluster stability issues that could be introduced by an application implementing a known anti-pattern through the use of alerting and human interactions like training or architectural stage gates. However, when we started to develop Aster, our as-a-service product, we realized that a better way was needed, kind of that non-human touch point. We couldn't rely on that anymore. And the better way is what we call guardrails. And this is this feature is being provided to DSE 6.8 users as an opt-in feature itself. So guardrails are like configurable tripwires in your cluster that either warn or prevent and throw an error for operations that are known anti-patterns for a cluster. So you can see a few examples of the guardrails here, and I'm going to walk you through another example later. But the initial guardrails we've put inside of 6.8 are focused on like number of indices, number of columns, the size of columns, collection sizes, consistency levels, trying to avoid huge partitions, huge hotspots. All of this is what we've created, codified, and put in to a global configuration for DSE. And the idea here is operators can configure these guardrails, and then devs can just go at it, and they'll know if something's happening at the application layer that the operator would not like to happen because of potential stability issues. So let me show you an example here. So I set up a guardrail. You can see here, the guardrails are configured in the Cassandra YAML. They're at the tail end. And in this example, when you go into DSE 6.8 and look at your Cassandra YAML, everything will be commented out for guardrails. So you opt in by uncommenting the first line that says guardrails. You see that without the pound sign. And then you'll see all the options of guardrails. I think there's something like 30 of them that we started off with 6.8. So in this example, I've uncommented and configured the secondary index per table failure threshold guardrail. What this says is if there is more than one secondary index per table, let's throw an error. So users, you know, don't create too many secondary indexes, which we know can cause stability issues. So here's the outcome. Oh, actually first, here's the table I used, just so you can see for our example. Simple little table, nothing fancy about it, one key, primary key. And in this example, I'm gonna create, before I enabled the guardrail, I was able to create really as many secondary indexes as I wanted to on this table. So here you see example from DataStax Studio, screenshot I took yesterday of me creating three different secondary indexes. Everything worked just fine, no issues, right? As soon as I implemented the guardrail though, you'll see I received some errors back. And so here, you'll see the error that comes back. Tables cannot have more than one secondary index. Failed to create secondary index, yada, yada, yada. And that error message is dynamic based on the guardrail you set. So if I set that threshold to 2 or to 4, whatever it is, after that many secondary indexes were created on the table, that tripwire would be set. Just a note, I happen to do this in one DDL statement, but the guardrail is global. So if I created one index and one DDL statement, that would have worked. If I went to try to create another one, I would have received an error. With guardrails, DataStax is helping users mitigate the chance that they accidentally implement anti-patterns in Cassandra that can cause known stability and degrade performance, right? So that's guardrails, pretty exciting, came out of our Astro development. Okay, so now let's focus a little more. So guardrails really focused on helping application developers develop quickly, do good things, while also giving operators some peace of mind knowing that they have some hard controls and hard tripwires they can put into the configuration of the cluster. Let's now focus really on the developer side of cloud native data and talk about what we've done with Graph in 6.8, because this is pretty interesting as well. So what you're looking at here is a real high level architecture diagram of how we've evolved the Graph solution in DataStax Enterprise 6.8. Just for background, DataStax 5, wow, 0 or 5.1, I can't believe I don't remember that right now. I was a product manager of Graph at the time. We introduced Graph inside of DataStax Enterprise. And at the time, the implementation was pretty cutting edge, but what it was really a Graph database sitting on top of Cassandra, right? And you saw that there was, you know, you worked with your graph data separately than your Cassandra data. The graph data projected a data model on Cassandra, but if you needed to write data into your graph, you had to do that with the graph APIs, they included bulk loading, writing, you know, individual pieces of the graph itself. You couldn't really mix or match graph and SQL data. And what we saw was a couple of things. We have had some early successes with Graph, no doubt about it. But we realized that providing Graph for Cassandra was much more powerful for the Cassandra community than providing a standalone Graph database. So with DSE 6.8, we've simplified the architecture for Graph users. And really, this is for Cassandra users. You know, we call this simplified architecture one model. We'll talk about that in just a second. If you remember anything about Graph though, with DSE 6.8, we're introducing Graph for Cassandra. That really summarizes it. What we've done is we've moved the data model for Graph inside of Cassandra itself. So this means as a developer, I can create a Graph data model using Cassandra CQL or using a graph API. I can work with my graph data and my Cassandra data because it's the same data. It's one model that can be read with either Gremlin, which is the graph API, or CQL, the Cassandra API. This simplifies the entire solution from, you know, for our operators, backing up, restoring, launching nodes, scaling graph, all of that works just like Cassandra, because it is Cassandra. For graph developers, or for developers, for those that are familiar with Cassandra, you now have a really easy way to understand what's happening in your graph. For graph developers, you have the Gremlin API, and we'll talk about all the great improvements there. High level, this is the evolution of graph in DSE 6.8. Graph for Cassandra, what you're looking at on the, I believe, the right side, where it just says Cassandra Schema 1 model. So let's take a deeper look and talk about what this means. So here's another kind of architecture slide that really, but it's pretty impactful because it describes what we're seeing our users doing with graph now in 6.8, some of our early adopters. And the scenario could be like this. Let's say I have an IoT application that uses Cassandra. It uses Cassandra because the data model aligns really nicely with time series data. Cassandra scales really large, so it keeps up with all the thousands to millions of sensors I have. And that IoT application is what you see on the right side of the screen, kind of little computers with little arrows. And basically what that represents is sensors writing partitions into Cassandra using CQL. Well, with DSE 6.8, without having to transform, migrate, move any data, I can simply expose that my CQL tables to the Cassandra engine as graph objects. What that allows is then someone that's familiar with Gremlin or knows about graph to go in and start traversing all of the connections, the network that is represented by my individual IoT sensors. Look for hotspots. Look for vulnerabilities from parts of my digital network that are overly connected, too many connections. Watch paths between sensors and how that information flows within my network. Right? This is what's possible with DSE 6.8 and Graph. It's not magic. It's actually pretty simple. This is an example of the DDL. Let's say I created a graph using Gremlin. This is the underlying CQL DDL that would be created underneath, or I could simply just create a graph using CQL itself. The important part here is what you see in the bold section. Basically, to turn any table into a graph object, I just use one of the width modulators and add the type of object I want to expose my CQL table as, whether that's a vertex, so like a thing, or an edge, a relationship between things. And it's that simple. So another example here, just to make this clear, on we're looking at a single data model inside of DSE 6.8 using DataStax Studio, looking at the schema viewer. On the left side of your screen, the graph view of data model, and I'm hoping I'm getting those correct for you at home, you're looking at what this data model looks like from a graph view. So if I wanted to just work purely with a graph mindset, understand connected components, paths, trees, stars, all of the, traversing, all of the great ways to think about your data from a graph-centric mindset, I can do that, right? And I can just simply work with Gremlin, work with my graph data model. However, I can also look at that same exact data as you see here on the right, which is the CQL view of that same data model. Same underlying base table, same data. And when we're talking about Cassandra, we're talking about very large data sets, which is super important, right? So here's an example of really querying or traversing, however you prefer to do so, the same database object. Here we're looking at, on the left, a traversal, a very, very simple one, that just looks up a graph based on a single vertex called human, and where the human has a property called name, of something. That's what the alchemy. Okay, on the right, I'm doing the same thing. I'm doing a SQL partition lookup, right? Getting one row back. Exact same underlying data. So imagine now you have one copy of the data that you can query in multiple different ways. What you can do with that, right? That's the excitement of graph in 6.8. And when you couple that with the elasticity provided by Kubernetes, right, you really have something that scales and grows with you as your needs grow. Okay, so we focused a lot on the one model side of graph, which is in itself pretty awesome, but there's a whole lot more to graph in 6.8. Through graph in DSE 6.8, we've made things so much easier for Cassandra users because of the one model, but we've also added a lot of developer enhancements for graph itself. The first is edge traversals are now first class citizens. And this means I can start traversing on an edge, like find me the relationship between two devices. That's what I care about, versus find me this device and then find me the relationship and then that device. And this is a pretty new concept in the graph data world, at least to have it in a distributed database. They have the ability to start traversing on edges. So that's pretty exciting, and we're getting a lot of good feedback there. Another great enhancement is really we've put more intelligence into the graph developer experience. So the first thing we did, we've created an intelligent indexing tool called Index4, which can just simply scan your traversals and create the right indexes underneath to ensure you have optimal performance of your graph operations. We've also added a lot more clear and enhanced errors, so developers really know why something errored out, what to do about it. And in some cases, the indexing engine will kick in the error itself to make a recommendation on a type of index that would resolve the error. There's better profiling and tracing, just overall a much easier and more intuitive way for both Graph and Cassandra developers to develop graph functionality with DSE 6.8. And finally, who knew simplifying an architecture would make things faster? No, that's a joke. I think everybody knows that. So the new graph in DSE 6.8 is significantly faster than anything we've seen previously. And sometimes, depending on the use case, traversals, all that kind of good stuff, whether you're talking about bulk loading, ingesting for a graph object, we saw three orders of magnitude improvements in performance at scale. And this we saw internally with our own benchmarks, as well as some external benchmarks. All right. So takeaway here, graph for Cassandra is what's in DSE 6.8, and it's awesome. All right, so now let's talk about two other really cool beta features before we kind of wrap things up here for today. With DSE 6.8, we've introduced two what we're calling experimental beta features. The first is really pretty close to GA, and it's meant to help Cassandra, Kubernetes operators work with Cassandra. This is something we call server-side backup and restore. Just plainly, you have the ability now to create backups, to create configurations for those backups, when you want them to run, where you want to store the backup, and to perform restore through SQL. This is not snapshotting for Cassandra. This is true, like point-in-time style backups that all occur through SQL itself, stored, on shared storage, off node, on node, in Google and AWS. Very, very cool. Check out the documentation for server-side backup and restore. The second is an experimental beta feature. We've had a lot of internal users and external, kind of early adopters, but it'll take one more release to really get it fully baked. And this is called storage attached indexes. So just plainly, this is real flexible where clause predicate support from Cassandra without the use of secondary indexes, without the need of having any Lucene-backed search tools to make it possible. This is hugely awesome for developers. I'm so excited for us to truly get this out. But it is beta right now. You're welcome to use it. If you have questions, you want to contact us because you like it, don't like it, we'd love to hear from you. And so please reach out. You'll see a way to do so in the resources. Awesome. Okay, so we just covered a lot of material. We saw how 6.8 combines the power of Cassandra for cloud data with the ease of automated operations, thanks to Kubernetes. We saw how DSE 6.8 helps bring more elasticity to your Cassandra clusters through faster scaling and recovery, as well as more efficient anti-entropy processes. We also saw how DSE 6.8 helps you accomplish more with your cloud native data, thanks to Guardrails and the new graph engine. So as you can see, DSE 6.8 helps you build better applications faster. Now let's talk about how you can take advantage of DSE 6.8. So with DataStax, there's a ton of ways to get involved and to get engaged. The first is to go out and get 6.8. Here's two ways to do so, and these are in your resources. You can go out and grab the full binaries or however you, Docker images, however you like to install software. You can also check out our newly promoted to like official production support from our labs environment tool called DataStax Desktop, which runs on your laptop. It's what I use to create the demos for today's presentation. And with a click of the button, you can spin up a local DSE 6.8 cluster and be on your way. So the second way you can engage is to learn more. You can do this by tuning into our awesome developer workshops. One of my friends and colleagues, Cedric Lundvin, is doing a wonderful job doing these. And I think tomorrow there's a machine learning AI workshop that he's presenting, and you need to go register for it, I saw, because you'll get a whole environment to work with as a part of it. Of course, you can always visit Academy, take self-serve, you know, learn on your own, at your own pace. And finally, you know, if you need us, we're here. You can either contact us officially through our website or engage within the community itself. Yep, awesome. So a couple more minutes, let's see here. All right, there was a question, where did it go? There it is. Will the Kubernetes operator replace what's called Op Center or the Lifecycle Manager that comes with DSE today? Over time, Kubernetes will be, you'll see two things happen. We will evolve the UI and the UX for, you know, the functionality you receive from Op Center today. And underneath the covers, you know, Kubernetes and particularly the management API will be used there. But you know, that's kind of forward looking. If I was standing up a cluster today and I was a experienced Kubernetes user, that's probably the way I would go. If I don't have any Kubernetes in my environment and I'm not incentivized to use it, right? There's not, you know, we see a lot of the enterprises we work with, there's a movement internal push to move to Kubernetes. But if that's not happening where you are and you want to use Op Center, awesome, go for it. That is a tool that we support and will continue to support for many, many years. So I think you have right now really two good options to choose from in which you can't go wrong. There was a question about how does Kubernetes know the new IP addresses of the two new nodes that were added? Yeah, on the very first slide, there was the second command showed what nodes, we'll call them pods, are available for Kubernetes. And Kubernetes will pick those, and you can have some influence on your within your Cassandra data center configuration file on where to put things. Sean, one of my friends from out in Los Angeles. Does the operator support all the modes of the workloads inside of DataStax Enterprise? So search, graph, analytics. This first version is focused on Cassandra itself. So if you're using graph and you're not using search or the embedded search or analytics in DSC, then you can use graph with it as well. You know, we're looking at how we add additional functionality to the Kubernetes operator over the coming months to add the other workloads as well. Does DataStax operator support Op Center? No, it does not. So they would, typically you would either use Op Center or use Kubernetes. I can't really imagine a scenario of using both at the same time. All right, a couple more minutes here. I know it's good to see a lot of familiar names here. we're going to download these questions. I can follow up later as well. But let's talk about something other than Kubernetes just for a second. There was a guardrails question I saw. Oh, where'd it go? So there was a question around guardrails. Are these guardrails for preventing or identifying supernodes? These would do the prevention of supernodes, you know, large partitions, those types of items. The idea is with guardrails to put some blocks in the database layer to prevent known bad bad things from happening. So, interesting question. Can I use my GraphQL query building skills directly with DSE Graph? That is an interesting question because the answer is not yet, but stay tuned. So that's I don't know this person that asked it, but that was a great kind of leading question for where things are heading. There's a question, are we planning to deprecate Solr? No, we are not. You'll see for you know, those of you that are users, existing customers, you know, we're talking with all of our customers right now, kind of giving an update here. And simple answer is no, and we can talk about that more in a follow-up if you have questions around that. Do we have multi-DC support with Kubernetes? That's an awesome question. Let's end with this one. Sweet. So in the Kubernetes world, there are some, you know, up until about two, 3 weeks ago, there were some best practices of really not having multi-region type deployments with Kubernetes because of some of the networking latencies that occur. Those recommendations are evolving. So, you know, Cassandra supports multi-region just right out of the gate. That's how we do the zero downtime. So I would expect to see more of how to do multi-data center and multi-region with Kubernetes and with the Kubernetes operator for Cassandra coming out in the coming weeks. So awesome. And like I said, we're able to download all of these questions and can follow up after. So thank you all for joining today. I don't have anything else. Ed, do you?
No.
Awesome.
This was great. Thanks for everybody that attended. Great questions. Look forward to seeing you all on follow-up webinars.
All right. Thank you.